Swanson is an author, blogger, journalist, activist, and radio talk show host. His books include, one of the books that he has just come out is War is a Lie, second edition, and that is available out in the foyer for sale. It's discounted for today for $15. It's a $20 book, and he will be available at the end of the event to sign the book. And you can use credit card to pay for it also if you don't have cash or check. David Swanson is, as I said earlier, involved with a group called World Beyond War. It's a group that is, the purpose of that group is to end war, and it is a great website, worldbeyondwar.org. He's the director and founder of that organization. And he is very, very dedicated and very active. Blogs regularly. He blogs at davidswanson.org and warisalie.org. And Cindy Sheehan, both of them have been here many times. Today is really the first time that we have them both together at the same time. Cindy Sheehan, peace mom, author, blogger, radio talk show host, and she became an anti-war activist after her son died in Iraq War on April 4, 2004, and soon after she came out against the war, and she has been doing that for a long time. And without any further ado, please give a warm Fresno welcome to both David and Cindy.
This is actually the second time I think that I've spoken here at the church. So it's wonderful that you have this available to you. I have been friends with David Swanson for many years. It was, I think we started communicating shortly after the Downing Street memo was, minutes were exposed on the news. It was a memo written to, what's his name, Tony Blair. Remember him? Prime Minister of Great Britain. Before the Iraq War, and David, if I get anything wrong, essentially it said.
It wasn't written, it was the minutes of the meeting.
Oh, minutes of the meeting. Sorry. So essentially this guy came over here from Great Britain, met with Condoleezza Rice. No?
George Tenet.
See, I don't know anything. I don't know. But anyway, essentially they said that the war is a given. They're going to attack Iraq, and we have to, they're going to have to get the intelligence to fit the policy. And so this was in 01, July, June. No, the memo happened.
Oh, that it happened.
The minutes happened.
Think of 02.
See, I don't know anything. I should let David tell the story. And so anyway, he started something called After Downing Street Coalition, and I joined as a peace activist. My organization, Gold Star Families for Peace, joined. And we actually testified in front of Congress on June 16, 2005. I know that because that was my sister's birthday. And I was one of the people who testified. And what was funny about it was that the news media, of course, wanted to paint us and Congressman John Conyers, who convened the hearing, as, you know, wackos, and they said that the Downing Street minutes, they were old news. It's like, if it's old news, how come nobody knows about it? That might have happened 4 years ago or 3 years ago, but absolutely nobody knows that it happened. And so of course, shortly after that, about 6 weeks after that, I was camping in a ditch in Crawford, Texas. So the peace movement kind of took off in that, the anti-war movement kind of took off in that direction. And David and I have worked on impeachment together. We've worked on, of course, anti-war together. And anytime I'm on the East Coast doing any of my crazy things, like Tour de Peace, when I rode my bike from California to Washington, D.C., book tours, whatever, David always welcomes me to Charlottesville and hosts an event. So when I found out he was coming to my state, not just my state, but you know, he's going to be pretty close to me when he was in the Bay Area. This isn't actually close to anything here in Fresno, except Fresno, but we have a nice chat coming up here. I think we spent 3 hours together, just David and I, ever. So anyway, it's just a pleasure and an honor for me to be able to work with David on this. David is one of the most dedicated anti-war, anti-imperialist activists in our movement today. He does a great service to not just our movement, but to humanity in exposing the lies of the U.S. Empire, and in doing it in such a, you know, such a scholarly yet accessible way. And so I think that sometimes if there's a weakness in our movement, besides the fact that since Barack Obama's been president, there's essentially been, hasn't been a movement, but if there's a weakness, we don't support each other. We don't support full-time activists who have really chosen a different, almost anti-American lifestyle to be activists. We sacrifice a lot of the so-called conveniences, comforts, and you know, other benefits of living in the society, which actually, when you do it for a long time, you find out there really, really are benefits of not trying to live outside the society and be a full-time activist. You don't have health care, you don't have a retirement, you don't have sick days, but you can look at yourself in the mirror every night. You can be proud of the fact, and I know David has done, that you did everything that day to make the world a better place. And what better benefit is that than that? I can't think of any, you know, there's no material benefit that outweighs that. So I just hope today that you do purchase his book. David is a full-time activist. He's got two little boys and a wife. It's his anniversary today. And so he's here. So David, let's talk about you now. Tell us about your new edition of War is a Lie.
Okay, well thank you Cindy, and thank you for all the work that you are doing, and thank you to Peace Fresno. I've been here a few times before, and I'm always happy to come, and thank you to Dan for everything that he does and his radio show. I do understand we're near some incredible national parks that I would love to come back and see sometime. And thank you to my wife for letting me be here. The weird thing I'm reminded of with Cindy recalling the Downing Street minutes, which were big news in the spring of 2005, that there was this official record of a meeting, you know, years before in England with the Prime Minister, and they knew that they were gonna, that the United States was gonna lie the country into a war, and had decided on a war while maintaining they were trying to avoid a war. And then, you know, that was supplemented by all sorts of additional information and documentation and minutes and memos and so forth. They've done endless investigations and whitewashes in England, and they're going to have their latest report coming out from the Chilcot Committee on July 6th, which really should have been July 4th. And in the United States, nothing like it, not even the pretense of any sort of truth, reconciliation, accountability, prosecution, nothing. But what I'm reminded of when this came out, and we said to Congress members and to so-called journalists and the White House press corps that this is news. This documents that what everybody assumed was true was actually true. They were intentionally lying us into a war. And they said, oh, we knew that. We knew that at the time. Well, did you write about it? Did you say it on the radio? Did you talk about it on, you know, Meet the Depressed? They just knew it, but it wasn't mentionable. And so it's old news, but it was never reported as news. Well, they've gotten much more open about this stuff as time has rolled on and the media has gotten worse. And what happened in 05 was the Democrats were in the minority. And so they had people like Cindy in unofficial minority hearings speaking truth to power and pretending that if they got the majority and chaired the committees, they were going to end the wars, impeach the criminals, help the poor, save the environment, you know. Well, what did people do in 2006? They said, hold on, we don't have time for speakers, meetings, and rallies. We got to work on voting. And they put everything into electing the Democrats. And the Democrats got the majority. And they got the chairmanships. And they said, what the hell do you want from us? Get out of here. And Rahm Emanuel, who ran the Democrats in the House in January 2007, completely shamelessly and openly told the Washington Post, in fact, even though every exit poll said that we got this first and foremost in order to end the war, we're actually not going to end the war. We're going to escalate it, keep it around for two more years because we really want to run against it again in 2008. Now, how do you run against, quote unquote, against, in opposition to something that you've been pursuing for the past 2 years and the previous years? Well, because you've labeled it a Republican war, right? I mean, and this is up through the current day. You've got a war in Afghanistan that, in terms of deaths, days, dollars, blood, suicides, troop deployments, is overwhelmingly Barack Obama's war. But if we ever get, you know, another Republican president and people find out there's still a war in Afghanistan, they're going to be scratching their heads. How did Bush get that war to the new guy with the eight-year gap? You know, because it's Bush's war. And Obama's been credited with ending for 8 years running, you know, while he tripled it and then, you know, slowly brought it down again. And yes, thank you, Dan, for the reminder that this is Memorial Day. We have now a war holiday, and in most cases, a war week and a war month of awareness of this and that every day of the year now. You can't get away from it, and very few peace holidays. I wrote another book about the peace movement of the 1920s and a treaty they created that's still on the books that bans all war and proposed a holiday, and some cities around the country are now getting their city councils to have a holiday celebrating that. But, you know, it's very rare, and we have to push back. I mean, this is something you can do every day when somebody mentions celebrating Memorial Day. You can say, are you serious? Why? You know, and it's not because we don't care about dead soldiers. A Vietnam vet against the war said to me 2 days ago in San Francisco at an event, and he said this in tears, let us remember the 58,000 dead from the Vietnam War. And I said, you are right, but let us remember 6,058,000 dead. Because they're humans too, because we care about them, because we're responsible for them, and because we have to educate the public that they exist. You know, tell people how many miles that wall in DC would have to be to include the dead from that war. The American War, as the Vietnamese call it, not the Vietnamese War. It was an American war, right? And if you go to Germany, or you watch Michael Moore's latest movie, and you ask anybody, what are the worst things the German government has done? What were the dates? How many people died, down to the man, woman, and child? Japan, same thing. An education of national shame and regret and commitment not to do it again. in the United States, there's absolutely, you try asking anybody, how many people did the United States kill to take over the continent, to destroy Vietnam, to destroy Iraq? You know, polls of Americans, where they think as many Americans died in Iraq as Iraqis, and that the Iraqis should be grateful, and that the Iraqis are grateful, and that those who think the Iraqis aren't grateful wonder why. You know, this is, you know, American attitudes. And so I wrote a book called War is a Lie 5 or 6 years ago, because there was this notion that there was something unique about 2003, that a president had lied the country into a war. Oh my God, never happened before. How could this happen? And I went and looked at every war I could find through US history, pre-US history, around the world, trying to find a war, you know, that's holding up a light, searching for an honest man, trying to find a war not based on a pack of lies, and I couldn't do it. Now, some of you may have your favorite, you know, justified war from the past, and you can ask me about it during the Q&A, and I'll tell you why it was not justified, and what the package of lies was that sold it and escalated it and continued it and beautified it after the fact. But every single war is based on a similar set of lies. I mean, there's 6 or 8 types of lies. They choose the ones that are going to work best, and they get the war going, and they tell completely different ones later, and completely different ones decades after the war happened. I mean, a lot of the justifications for World War II didn't exist until after World War II was over, you know. And so I looked at public reaction, and I found that in 2001 and in 2003, in some polls, you had a majority of Americans saying, yes, let's have a war. And in both cases, within a year and a half, and ever since, in every poll I've ever seen, you had a majority saying, never should have started that war. Right? So there's a need to know something sooner, a need to learn more quickly. Right? And so I wrote a second edition of the book, looking at the past 5 or 6 years. What have we learned? What are we doing better? Where are we still falling down? You know, because when people find out about the lies that get wars going, the support for the wars drops off dramatically. And you look at when we were working on the Downing Street Minutes and other evidence of Iraq war lies, as the belief that Iraq was based on lies went up, just like a week or two later, disapproval of the war followed right along in the polls, right? And when people find out what happened to the USS Maine in Havana Harbor, what didn't happen in the Gulf of Tonkin, what didn't happen with the ships that Wilson or Roosevelt talked about, what public relations firm coached a girl to pretend that babies were taken out of incubators and so forth, did the support for those wars just drops off? And so you look at the past several years with lies about mountaintop rescues, lies about dictators in Libya promising to massacre civilians and handing out Viagra for mass rape, lies about where ISIS came from, lies about a plane going down in Ukraine, lies about the drone war in Yemen, the lies about the success of the Iraq surge carried over to justify the escalation in Afghanistan, you know, that all of these lies, when are we recognizing them and when are we not? And in 2013 was really our shining moment of greatest encouragement, because we had a president and a secretary of state who made a hard pitch for a massive bombing campaign of Syria. And the president of the United States said, look at my Nobel Peace Prize, look at my liberal credentials, and look at these YouTubes of children being killed with chemical weapons, and I have absolutely nothing I'm willing to show you, but I swear to you I have incontrovertible evidence who did it. And because the wrong types of weapon were used and I know who did it, we must bomb Syria or be in favor of killing children with chemical weapons.